Amen and amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The name of the Lord is a, thank you. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. My God, and the righteous run in and they are saved. I just feel like we're going to have a good time in the Lord this morning. Mom, go ahead and share what the Lord placed on your heart as we were in praise and worship, and then we're going to begin. Don't feel like, my God, I want to be in a hurry this morning. I just feel like we're going to take our time and God is going to get the glory out of everything that we do this morning. Go ahead and begin to share.
Okay. You know, this morning, you know, this phrase, it came to me so vividly. Celebrate Jesus.
My God.
And when I heard that song, He is risen from the dead and He is Lord, I understood what that meant. Amen. This morning. So I just want to give God the praise and to give Him the glory and the honor, because I know that He has been directing my path. And Pastor Smith, He has been directing your path. So you just stand in your purpose.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen and amen. To God be the glory. My God, great things He has done. So lovey the world that He gave us His Son. My God, I feel like I just want to wait on the Lord and wait for Him, my God, to give us, my God, just a time on when we need to go. And while we wait, I'm going to pray. There's a lot to get through. There is so much that He continues to add to me, continue to impart divine revelation, but we're going to pray. Before I pray, I want us to begin with just this illustration. What I have here is just a glass. The glass has water in it. And if you're thinking that He's going to preach about the glass being half full or half empty, I'm not. We're going to talk this morning. We're going to have a conversation about faith and fear. And to help you to understand that faith and fear, as I said at the onset of service, they are influencer. They will influence what you do. If it is faith that you set in motion, faith will influence what comes next in your life. If it is fear that you set in motion, fear will influence what you do and what comes next in your life. And I've got water. And I got up this morning and the Holy Spirit just began to move me in a direction. I've got water and I've got a bottle that has oil in it. And I'm just going to pour. They commingle together. But after a while, the oil begins to separate from the water. The oil begins to separate. And if I were to place my hand here and to shake it up, after a while, they may mix and commingle together. But there is going to be a clear distinction, and you're starting to see that right there. That will happen. And the Lord simply sent me here to say this to you. And we can just stop right here and we can just sing praise and worship for the rest of the day. Fear and faith can't coexist in your heart. It can't. So what I also saw in my mind, because you see, it is the water that is, and I don't want to say the water is the faith, but what I kept seeing is, because the water needs to be on top, we get creative in that we do this. And even though we do, there is that separation again that you will see. You'll start seeing it right here. And it is of such that the oil will always float to the top. The question is why? The oil is less dense than the water. And because it is less dense than the water, it will always, always float to the top. Spirit of the living God, we come before You this morning, my God, and we wait on You. We come into Your presence. My God, You have shared Your mind thus far with us. And we follow the lead in that You said, my God, we ought to celebrate You. what you have placed on my heart and my mind to share with your sons and your daughters. Again, we continue down the pathway that you have set before us and that you said to us before. You continue to say to us, you ask us the question, rather, can you hear me now? The emphasis you shared with us over the past couple of weeks is, it's on now. Can you hear me now, right now in this moment? Can you hear what I'm saying? We started this conversation at Hebrews chapter 1:1. God at sundry times and diverse manner spoke, and you're asking us the question, can you hear what I'm saying to you now? This morning, you've broadened the horizon, and you want us to, my God, answer the question. You want us to focus on what you're saying to us. Can you hear me now? And you're saying to us that this too will pass. Good God. And you see, this is the reason why we come and we celebrate you. Why? Because that which was a hindrance, it is now, my God, going to be far removed from us. Thereby and therewith, we continue on this journey. There is somebody, Shandoloboko Sataya, Eba Diandoloboko Telebe Kibibia Sheko Torobo Sandaya Nanama. You have been held in check for far too long. You've been held in check for far too long. And I just see, my God, the Lord just breathing upon you. And because he is breathing upon you, two things happen. He breathes upon you to blow away the things that have attached itself to you. And he said, the next thing I do is to breathe in you. So I breathe upon you to blow away the things that have attached itself and the things that you have attached yourself to. And in the process of blowing those things away, I am breathing new life, new insight. I am breathing life into you. Because what held you expressed to you that this is it for you. Thereby and therewith you live according to that which attached itself to you and influenced what you did and what you have done. But he said, this morning I've created this space and this opportunity, and I'm going to breathe upon you, removing the things, Shebandoloboko Sataya, that have attached itself to you. And in the process of doing so, I'm going to breathe new life in you. Spirit of the living God, we come before you this morning. And whatever it is you want, whatever it is you want to do, God, I quiet my mind and my heart, and I say, have your way. Have your way this morning. Have your way. I get the sense that some of us this morning, God, have brought some things that we thought were valuable to us. Thereby, it caused our value to devalue. And this is what you're after this morning. You are going to restore us. In the process of you doing so, God, we're going to celebrate, my God, what you have done and what you're getting ready to do. We look to you this morning, Lord God, and we say thank you in Jesus' name. He gave me two passages of scripture, but as we continue to worship, there's two more passages of scripture that he has laid on my heart. I'm going to read what he has given me initially, and then we will go and we will look at the other two passages of scripture. Hebrews chapter number 10 is where we go this morning. We start at verse 35. Hebrews chapter number 10, we start at verse 35. And it says, therefore, do not cast away your confidence, my God, which has great reward. So your confidence in God, he is saying, don't cast it away, because it is your confidence in God, in spite of the circumstance, in spite of the situation, that kept you going. You could have given up and you could have quit. And that which, good God, have attached itself to you and you have allowed, my God, to operate in and around your life when it comes and when it acts and it being itself begins to, by God, rob you and sap your energy and everything. And it brings you to that place where you want to give up and you want to quit. He said it is his confidence in you, which is like just a streak of light that offer hope to you in your dark days that help you going. Preaching as the Holy Spirit leads me here this morning. I don't know where I'm going, but I know this journey that he's taken me on, my God, it is going to be good. Just like, get me some water, please, sir. So he said, do not cast away your confidence, which is your great reward. Watch this. For you have need of endurance. And that word endurance, God, thank you. That word endurance, again, I'm preaching as I go along and the Holy Spirit imparts it unto me. I'm giving it to you. I may not get to my notes. That word endurance is where you get the word, the Greek word, eupomone. Eupomone means to be held under until you're approved. Amen. So the word endurance, it comes from this Greek word eupomone, to be, which means to be held under, my God, until you're approved. So even though I hear you, God, I hear you like never before, even though you may find yourself in a situation where it seems as if, my God, it is oppressive, and it seems as if, my God, as we read in Psalm 88, that you have been crying, and it seems as if God has not heard your cry. You think about this, God has held you there because there is a process. I hear him saying you have to go through the process, and even though it was your choice to do what you did, he could not remove you out of where you were because there was a process. There were some things that needed to be mature in you. And so you had to endure. You had to experience eupomone. You had to be held there until you're approved. And now you are approved. You have demonstrated, you have disciplined yourself while you were going through, you're going through, and it is your discipline. It is what you did, my God, while you were going through that grabbed the attention of God. And God is now saying, can you hear me now? This too will pass. Mama. He's saying it will pass because you have demonstrated and you have illustrated to me that in spite of the pain and the heartache and the misery and the suffering and everything that came against you, you have demonstrated to me while you were in this that I am more important to you than anything else. And you kept your eyes and your gaze on me. And because, my God, you have demonstrated this to me, I come now. And I just feel that of the Lord just to breathe upon you. And that's what he's saying. He's coming this morning to do. He is coming to breathe upon you. And when he breathes upon you, the thing, my God, or the influence, that which would have kept you at bay and prevent you and annoyed you and antagonize you and cause you to want to cuss and to swear and to do things that you like, but you're going to hate what you did. He say, this morning, I break the influence of it over your life. Somebody pray this morning. I'm going somewhere and I'm taking you this morning into the presence of the Lord with me. Mama Sheba Ndolobokos. It has been hard, but he's saying that you have demonstrated to me in these difficult times and in these difficult seasons that, yeah, I am Lord. I am Lord in your life and over your circumstances. Eupomone, endurance. For you have need of endurance, so that after you have done, my God, the will of God, you will receive his promise. So you have endured, you have demonstrated, and now he's saying the reason why these things, I am breathing upon you. In other words, he's saying I'm clearing the way. The things that would have clouded your judgment, this thing or this influence that would have prevented and hindered you from going and doing and becoming and being everything that I've called you and caused you to be. I am removing it from you. So he's simply saying to you this morning to stand up and to look up ahead, because your journey continues from this point on. Watch this. For yet a little while, and he who will come, my God, will come and not tarry. And I believe that this morning he has come. This morning he has come. My God, no wonder he led us to the path where we sang the song, "He is Lord." He is Lord. He has risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, because what he's coming to do this morning is to break the influence of that thing over your life, and you are free. I hear in my spirit, I'm going to preach to you as I hear it in my spirit, he who the Son is set free is free indeed. No more shackles, no more pain. Turn around and look. You won't even feel the breath or the influence of that thing when you look at it, knowing where you are. When you turn and you look and you knew that it was there, it will provoke fear and doubt and anxiety. And I want you to quit and want you to give up and abort, my God, the future and the expected. And let me say this to you this morning. Turn around and look. And see if you see or feel, my God, the sense and the fear, my God, that this individual, this group, my God, this community, this you name it, whatever it is that you attach yourself to that used to create fear inside of you. Think about your destiny and your destination that you've always sat down in the quiet and you consider. And every time you sit, you ponder, you consider, and you think. And you think about the influence of that thing and how it negatively impacts you and your decision to move forward. Sit in the presence of God today and think about where God has called you to do that which he has called you to do. And that thing that used to come, my God, and trip you up, my God, you are in the presence of the Lord. And I dare whatever that thing is to make itself known or to manifest itself in any way, shape, or form this morning. My God, you are on a collision course with your destiny, your God-ordained destiny. God says to you this morning, my God, that I'm breathing upon you, and I'm breathing upon you. And because I'm breathing upon you, that thing or those things, my God, the places, whatever it is that, my God, you have allowed to attach itself to you and you became connected to it, that influences what comes next out of your life or what you do. God said this morning, I'm breathing upon you. And because I'm breathing upon you, and I am breaking the influence that that thing exerted over your life. So when you turn to the right, to the left, you look above or beyond, that thing is no longer there to demand or to influence what you do next. My God, he said, I'm breathing in you. I'm breathing new life in you. Can you hear me now? This too shall pass. This too shall pass. It shall pass because God has now got himself into the mix of everything that you were dealing with and wrestling with. And because he, my God, is now in the fight with you, my God, he stand and he present himself. And there is nothing under the earth, in the earth, above or below the earth can change or stop the hand of God from moving you from where you are to where he needs to get. Faith and fear, there are influencers. But just like I put the water and the oil in this glass, there is a clear distinction if you were to look. You see, the water, the oil is above and the water is below. The oil is above because it is less dense. And because it is less dense, it always floats to the top. So that which, my God, the enemy try to keep down. He tried to downcast and to depress and to cause you not to rise to the occasion. The Lord simply sent me here to tell you this morning, my God, that he is now breathing upon you. And because he breathed upon you, the good God of my salvation, the thing that sat upon you like the oil sitting on top of the water, he is breathing those things away. It will not. Ah, God help me this morning. Let me not get ahead of myself. Watch this. For yet a little while, he who will come and not tarry. Now watch this. It says, now the just shall live by faith. Good God. But if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in them. So what he's simply saying to you this morning, because he is now doing this, my God, the expectation is that you will continue, my God, to move ahead. God is simply saying that if you make the decision to regress back to where you are coming from, he said, even if you were to go back there, it is a place of discomfort. It is not a place that you will be welcome anymore. He said, I have fix the past in such a way that even if you were to go back there to try and rest a little while, it will become uncomfortable. It will become distasteful. So my God, the only option for you is to move forward. Can you hear me now? This too will pass. Let me read verse 39, but it says, but we are not of those who draw back to perdition, my God, but to those who believe, my God, to the saving of the soul. Verse 1 of verse 11, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things that are not seen. Faith, it is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things that are not seen. Can you hear me now? This too will pass. And I want to begin my conversation with you. Not my conversation. The Lord wants to begin his conversation with you. Let us go to 2 Kings chapter number 7. When we go to 2 Kings chapter number 7 and you begin to read 2 Kings chapter number 7, it opens up and it tells them that, my God, then Elijah said, hear he the word of the Lord. About this time tomorrow, a measure of flour will be sold for a shekel. And why would Elijah declare this? Elijah stood up in the midst of a famine, my God, that Israel was experiencing. And he declared the word of the Lord, by this time tomorrow, things are going to change. Simply came to say to somebody this morning, Mandoloboko Shata, by this time tomorrow, this time, circumstances, your situation, everything that has harassed and prevented you from being everything that you can be in God, it is going to be a thing of the past. By this time tomorrow, things are going to change. Elijah stood up in the middle of this crisis and in the middle of this famine, and he declared the word, and somebody had the audacity to oppose him and to say, what in the world are you talking about? Are you kidding me? It's been this way for a very long time. And because it's been this way for a very long time, normally what we see when we are coming out of this, it is not an instant where it just changes in a matter of 24 hours. In other words, there is a process. There are man-made rules and legalistic rules that man has put in place that will influence the transformation of circumstance and situation. But the Lord simply sent me here to tell you this morning, because what he is doing, my God, he is breathing on you, my God, and because he breathes on you, the place, my God, that have exerted the influence over your actions and what you do next, he must breathe and break those chains and those shackles, and he must now free your mind to begin to think and begin to imagine and begin to dream and begin to, my God, get to that place where the inner man now begins to have conversation with him. Thereby, he can reveal to you what is getting ready to come. He breathes upon you, my God, and when he breathes upon you, he clears the air, if you will. So the thing that would have restricted and the thing that would have limited you, when God breathed upon you, he gives you space, my God, so you can stand up, and now you can stand up and you can reach around, and the thing is no longer there to restrict you. And because you're no longer restricted, my God, you have some time, my God, to process what he's doing in this moment. You begin to look around because you understand what it's like to live a life that is constricted and one that is restricted. In other words, you were living as if you were in a straitjacket, but God has to break the influence of the thing that exerted influence over you that prevent and stop you from being everything that you, my God, he has called you to be. Can you hear me now? This too will pass. Elijah stood up in the middle of this, and my God, when you read 2 Kings chapter number 7, it says that there was a man who was in the king's army. He was a part of the king's, my God, persons who would carry and share information with the king. And he stood up when the word of the Lord was declared. And he stood up in this moment. And I want to read his words to you. And I want you to understand that what God has declared over you, there are some naysayers that come and dare say some stuff as it relates to what God has declared unto you. But I want to declare this so you get this in your mind. Watch this. It says, Elijah said, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow about this time, my God, a measure of flour will be sold for a shekel and 2 sheaves of barley for a shekel at the gate of Samaria. Watch this. So an officer on whose hands the king leaned answered the man of God and said, look, kababashe. If the Lord would have made windows in heaven, could this thing be, my God? And he said unto him, in fact, you shall see it with your eyes, but you shall not eat of it. God has declared to you, and he has declared to me, that the thing that influences the inactivity in your life, prevented and stopped you, Mama Shiba Yekobo Kosaka Tia Labandibiosha, Hello Bokosi, Yinda Yia Nama, no Mosha, Tedebekoso. The influence of that thing is broken over your life. In fact, I hear in my spirit the Lord saying, enough is enough. Because if it was up to that thing that held you in check, you would have stayed there for the rest of your life. And because that thing would not let you go, God now has to come and he has to exercise authority and dominion over that thing and break the whole of that thing over your life. And he declared to you that you are free. Who the Son has set free is free indeed. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? This too will pass. The Bible said in 2 Kings chapter number 7 that the very thing that was declared, it became a reality within 24 hours. It didn't have to follow the legislated man-made rules in order to become a reality and for things to change for you. Because God spoke it and he declared it, it is coming to pass, and there is nothing that man can do, have done, and will ever do to stop the thing that God has declared to become a reality in your life and in mine. He is Lord. He is Lord. He has risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And I declare to you that the thing that I've held you in check for a very long time, its influence have been broken. Because God says, I breathe upon you. And he breathes upon you to blow those things away. So when he blows those things away, you know what it feels like, the presence, my God, when that thing is around you, you know what it feels like. You got up this morning, you didn't even know what it is. All you know is that something has changed and there's a shift that has taken place. And he just simply sent me here to confirm to you that it is his hands that have breathed upon you. And I want to say this to you this morning as I hear it in my spirit. He wants you to put it to the test. So the thing that exerted influence over you, my God, he wants you to stand and he wants you to move in the direction that he instructs you to move and see if that thing, my God, manifests or shows itself to begin to create any type of impedance towards your destiny. Put him to the test, he said, and see if he is not God and his word is not true. The Bible declared that this man that stood, my God, and opposed that which God declared. Watch this. Verse 3 of 2 Kings chapter number 7, it says, "Now therefore four leprous men, my God, at the entrance of the gate, they came one to another and they asked the question, why sit we here and die? If we enter the city, they may have pity upon us." And that's the question that he wants me to ask you this morning. Your leprous condition has been with you for a very, very long time. These four leprous men. Leprosy, you see, it was a disease wherewith and whereby when they live in the times in which they live in the Bible days, they had to openly declare and to call themselves unclean. They find themselves in dire situation where they are hungry and they're starving. Again, famine was upon the land. And they sat there and they begin to reason among themselves. And they say, listen, if we stay here, we're going to die. If we go into the city, chances are somebody may have mercy upon us. And they got up and they decide to walk. And this is what I want you to hear, understand, to know, is that when you continue to read the text in 2 Kings chapter number 7, it's so powerful that the feeble feet of four leprous men was marching towards, my God, an army that were living and enjoying the best of life. And God caused the feet of four leprous men to sound like a mighty army. And these men who were trained soldiers, they heard the feet of four. I want you to know that the enemy is so afraid of you. That's the reason why he tried to immobilize you. God caused the feet of four leprous men to sound like a mighty army. And when, my God, the men who were trained soldiers heard this, they reasoned and they said, my God, our enemies, they have formed an alliance and they're coming towards us and they run away. This too will pass. Can you hear me now? Their circumstances change because they dare to get up and to try and to prove and to test God amidst their difficult times. This too will pass. Second passage of scripture I want to bring to your attention is where the Lord is saying. So two things he's saying. By this time tomorrow, my God, things are going to change. And by this time next year, your circumstances are going to change. Genesis chapter number 18 and 10, 2 Kings chapter number 4. When you go to Genesis chapter number 18 and 10, this is the story with Abraham and Rebekah. And she is barren, Abraham and Sarah rather, she is barren and she can't have a child. The Bible said that God shut up her womb. And again, remember the word that we talked about earlier, the word endurance. It comes from the Greek word eupomone, which means to hold on there until you are approved. And God is saying that, my God, I have held you here until you are now approved. And I am going to release you and I'm going to do more with, my God, your tomorrow than I was able to do with your yesterday. Shebe doya namana nama shebe doloboko satya. Go before us, God. Ah, she's in the latter stage of her life. She lived, and the expectation is that when I was younger, I would have a child, and I would bear this child. I would run around with this child, and everything that she did, she could not have this child. I'm going to get back to my text in Hebrews chapter number 10 and 11 in a moment. Couldn't have this child when she was young. And everything inside of her, my God, that would have allowed her to embrace the child when she was younger. My God, she spoke from a heart and a place, my God, where she was heard. And in fact, God came. And when God came and visited them in the form of an angel, the Bible said that three angels came, three men walked up to the camp of Abraham. Abraham recognized who they was. He invited them to come in. And there's a conversation that this angel was having, my God, with Abraham. And he said, Sarah, your wife, is going to have a child by this time next year. By this time next year. And you see, the thing about it, can you hear me now? This too will pass. The barrenness that you experience, it is getting ready to change. It's 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 getting ready to change. Abraham and this angel is having a conversation, and he declared to him that, my God, guess what? Next year, about this time, you are going to be celebrating what God has done in your life. Abraham is in one room in the tent. Sarah is in another room in the tent. And when she heard what was declared, when she heard what was declared and what's getting ready to take place in her life, she looked, Mom, at her current situation. And she looked up ahead as to what God was declaring about her future. And when conventional wisdom, knowledge, and understanding robbed her or caused her to forfeit what God declared about her, the Bible said that she laughed on the inside. Let me say that again for somebody. When she stood in her present moment, having gone through so much, God visited her, breathed upon her. As the Bible would often put it, it puts it in a way that this disgrace, because you see, to live in the times in which she lived, and for a woman not to be able to produce a child, she was considered a curse. And to have to shadabaya mama sekoto, to have to live with what the culture dictated to her that you are considered a curse. She lived under the umbrella of being called a curse. If not openly, secretly. And now God stands up. He comes to visit them because of the cry that constantly comes from her. And when the angel came and he, thank you, Lord. When the angel came and saw she was at a place, it's this duplicitous place where there was faith and fear in her heart. He decided that I am going to speak to the faith that I see inside of her, and the fear that is inside of her begins to, my God, interfere with the word that God declares about her future. Faith, Shekataya Babasi. Faith, allow her to stand and to hear the conversation, Mama Nayama. Faith, allow her to stand and to hear the conversation in its entirety. Fear, Mesataria Baba Shebebe Kosataya, cause her to look at her current situation. And know you have a heart that is duplicitous in its response, because half of her heart, her heart, my God, held her there, but her mind embraced fear. So her heart allowed her to stand there Because you see, when God began to speak to us about our tomorrow, he began to speak in our spirit. And you see, it is our spirit. Our heart is that place where the word of God is sown. Our heart is a good fertilizer. Anything we plant in it is going to grow. But while it is true that our heart is a good fertilizer and what we plant there is growth, our mind is also, my God, it is that thing where if our mind and our heart is not aligned with what is being declared, because you see, my mind, my God, will cause me to look at my current circumstance and what is declared, and my mind will say to me, this does not make sense. Just like how the man stood up in 2 Kings chapter number 7, and he declared by this time tomorrow, in his mind, he could not conceptualize this circumstance changing just like that. And this is where Sarah was. Her heart allow her to hear the conversation and what God declared. And so now her mind, having heard what was declared, her minds begin to play trick on her and cause her to laugh. And when she was confronted and asked, why did you laugh? She said, I did not. And in some sense, yes, she was right. Because it is what was conceived in the mind that was making its way towards her heart. And you see, God had to now come, and he had to blow all of that away from her. And now he had to breathe life into her. He had to breathe a new belief system into her. He had to now breathe into her his perspective and his insight, and to help her to understand that your current situation does not dictate the outcome, my God, of your future. It may be that you were in this space for a very long time, and it may be that the oppressive hands, my God, have held you in check, but this time he stands up and he's having a conversation with you in your here and now about your tomorrow. And he declares to you that by this time next year, you are going to bring forth this child. By this time next year, my life, my circumstance, and my situation changes. By this time next year, I am no longer preaching and teaching from Zoom. I am going to be in a church. By this time next year, the blessings of the Lord will follow me wherever I go. By this time next year, men are going to sit and to wonder and to think, who is this and where did he come? By this time next year, it is nothing that I have done that will cause what God is going to do. But you see, because Sister Monica, I have been held in check, and I've had to endure a whole lot. But in the process of enduring and going through my going through, God has tested my heart in that moment. And now he's going to come and reward me according to, my God, the discipline. And even though it hurt and it was painful and it was hard, and the opportunity presented itself for me to abort the process and to quit and to give up, my God, every time I got up, I was able to get up because he kept breathing in me. And because he breathed life in me, every day I get up, I can stand and sing and testify what the songwriter said in that. He said, great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All that I've needed, O God, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. I got a few minutes now just to teach. Did you know that your faith has a voice? Let me let that marinate here before it gets here. Did you know that your faith has a voice? Did you know that? All right, you're looking at me with that quizzical look. We'll get to that in a moment. Did you know that your faith has a voice? Did you know that God responds to faith? Did you know that your faith will, my God, move the hand of God to act? Did you know that? And just in case you did not know, well, here goes. Paul, when he spoke in, my God, Hebrews chapter number 10, he was encouraging the church to throw away, my God, he encourages the church not to throw away or to cast away their confidence, which have great recompense or reward. So the question is, why was it necessary to hold on to your confidence or your faith in God? We're going to get to it. It's good. It is necessary for you to hold on to your confidence or your faith in God because after you have finished going, because after you are finished doing your part, my God, and you're looking or expecting God to do his part without faith or confidence in him, you will quit and you will abort the process, thereby leaving you to think that God does not care much for me. Having done everything to stand, it is going to take faith for you to stand there, even though you do not see any telltale sign that things are getting ready to change. But God is simply saying to you, just stand there. Again, that word, eupomone, to be hold under until approved. It is going to take faith for you to stay there, even though there is no sign that things are changing. But you think about it this way. You think about a cake that you bake and you put it in the oven. It has to stay in the oven for a period of time for you to begin to see the change. And I want to say to you this morning, my God, you see, for me, the Lord helped me to understand. And this is why I'm able to stand in spite of it, Mom. He helped me to understand that I have cultivated you rather in the furnace of affliction. So in spite of what it is that I'm going through and in spite of how difficult it is, because he spoke to me back then when I started this journey and he helped me to understand that I've furnished you, my God, I've cultivated you rather in the furnace of affliction. In spite of how hot and difficult and hard it is, I know to stay there because he is doing something. He is working something out in me. In fact, he showed me once, you think about a sword that is fashioned and formed. They put it in the fire and when they do and it becomes blazing red hot, they take it out, they begin to take a hammer or an anvil and they begin to strike it and begin to shape and begin to form. And in fact, they look at it and sometimes what they do, they begin to blow some things or begin to remove some things. Why? Because there is an end product and there is a process whereby that sword, my God, is fashioned and formed to become as effective as it needs to be. In there, because God is going to get the glory out of your life. There is a process. And you have to quit, as I hear it, you have to quit opening the oven and looking at the cake to see if anything is happening. My God, you've got to understand that somebody would have done the work and they would have put instruction on a box. Get me a cake mix box over there, son. And it would have said to you that you need to follow, my God, the following instruction, and you put it in the oven for 30 or for 40 minutes. You don't need to open it because every time you open it, you're affecting the end product. Stand in there. God is working something in you. And you will be able to say like David, it was good for me that I was afflicted that I might learn. The scripture says, for yet a little while, he that will come shall come and will not tarry. And the question is, are you expecting God to show up? That's the question. Because if he stelled you to stand in there, he is going to show up after a little while. Watch this. Expectancy is the breeding ground, my God, for fear and for faith at the same time. Who, my God, who and where you lay your expectancy will determine the outcome you, my God, it will determine rather the outcome you interact with at the end. So when you find yourself in a situation where things are the way they are, and the Lord tells you to hang on in there, what is it that you set in motion that determine your next step? Is it faith or is it fear? Because what you set in motion will lead, will lead. It will control what comes next. Question. Ah, here is where it gets good now, Mom. The question that he wants me to ask you is simply this. Are you waiting in God or are you waiting on God? My, I feel like I want to get happy and excited. What's the difference? Are you waiting in God or are you waiting on God? Watch this. The difference is when you wait in God, you get in the process. You make your petition known to him, my God. In other words, you get in the presence of God. And when you get in the presence of God, you begin to have conversation with him, my God, about why are things the way they are. And you have conversation with him about the future and the expected end that he talked to you about. And at the same time, because you are in his presence and things are the way they are, he begins to tell you what to do, what adjustment you need to do, and what your next steps are. When you are not in God, but you are outside of the presence of God, your conversation is different because it becomes selfish and self-centered because you're now focused on you, not understanding that you must get into his presence, because what David declared unto us, that in your presence there is fullness of joy and at your right hand there are pleasures forevermore. If you never get in his presence to have conversation with him about where you are and what you're going through, you will do things to self-sabotage your own future. I feel like I want to preach now. Paul puts it this way, finds himself where he's preaching and teaching the gospel. And there was a man by the name of Alexander the coppersmith, my God, that withstood him and began to do some evil things, my God. But Paul says, as he declared, Alexander the coppersmith did me much harm. But because I was in the presence of God when I had conversation with him, I was able to pray that God do not hold the thing that he did to his charge. I want to ask you the question, as I just feel, my God, the ever presence of God right now. Are you waiting in God or are you waiting on God or are you waiting outside of God? Because you see, when you wait in God, this is where he wants us to move and to get to, where we wait in him, where we come into his presence. And this is where, my God, it gives us an opportunity to cast our cares and our concerns upon him. This is where it gives us an opportunity to begin to dialogue with him. This is where it gives us an opportunity to take, my God, some of the things that we think, feel, and believe and what we want him to do, my God, to those things that viciously oppose us. We take it before him and we begin to say, God, because you see, when you're in his presence, you're having honest conversation. It's not something that is diluted. You're having honest conversation with him. And you're saying, God, this is what I think, feel, and believe about that. And the Lord will now take scripture and he will put scripture beside your reasoning, my God, and your conversation with him. If that thing that opposes you is an enemy, the Lord will say to you, love your enemies and do good to them that despitefully use you and say all manner of evil about you. This then give you an opportunity now to have a rebuttal or to say to God, I can't do it because of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. God will now then give you his insight as to how you can do it. Can you hear me now? This thing will pass. This mindset to want to disturb and to disrupt your future and your expected end will come to pass. It is coming to an end. I just feel like I want to jump over to here for just a quick second and just bring this in and tie this in for somebody. You look at where you are. You look at the plans that God declared for you. You look at the struggles that you're currently dealing with. And I want to bring this to you again as I get it from the Lord. You think about the parable with the wheat and the tear. You think about the parable with the wheat and the tear. When you read the parable with the wheat and the tear, it says that the owner sowed good seed. But while he went to sleep, an enemy came and sowed tares amongst the wheat. And when the wheat and the tares begin to grow, it was uncovered that, oh my goodness, this is not what we started out with. But we're in a place where things have taken an ugly turn. And the answer or the question that came is that, should we take the tares, uproot them, because they have now present themselves, they are now pronounced. The master said, this too will pass. Don't do anything. The question is, how is it that the wheat, kabayedo dodo bosha, and the tares could have grown and it only up to a certain point where the distinction is now created, where the alarms are sounded? You see where I'm going with this? I'm talking about the seeds that have been planted in your heart. And it is only now and only now where they become pronounced and you want to do something about it. And God is simply saying to you, can you hear me now? This too will pass. And you're saying, well, preacher, how will this pass? And the Lord is saying, don't do anything about it. Even though the enemy meant it for evil, the Bible said that it was declared, let the wheat and the tares grow together. And then the heart, when it comes to harvest time, that's when you will separate. And notice, if you will, when you read that text, the Bible said that the tares were harvested, they were tied in a bundle and they were burnt. There is, mama shebe ndolobo kosataya, a great distinction and a separation that God is creating. Even though the tears may overshadow and prevent, my God, anything and anyone from interacting with you, the tears are going to be removed. And the Lord is saying it will be declared that an enemy did this. And you see, the thing about this is that the expectancy is that there was a bountiful harvest that should have come as a result of the seeds of wheat that were sown. But with the tares being planted amongst the wheat, it affected the outcome. But the Lord is simply saying that, just like how there was a famine, and you should have gotten, say you were supposed to get 100 pounds, my God, of wheat, and you go to the market and you would have sold it for $1 a pound. And the expectation is that you would have gotten $100 for the 100 pounds. Now you only get 50 pounds. But the economics... God, I love you this morning. Sister Monica, the economics is of such that because there is a famine, the price, the price for the wheat will now be sold for $2. So even, Jesus, even though it's only 50 pounds that you get, you still get $100. This is the God that we serve. Even though the enemy meant it for evil, the enemy meant it for evil, you should have harvested 100 pounds and you should have sold it for $1. But because he sold the wheat and the tears, the harvest that you received was only 50 pounds of wheat. And you're saying to yourself, I need $100 in order to sustain and to keep and to keep above ground. But God created, my God, the type of atmosphere where there is a famine, and you still brought the 50 pounds to the market and you got $2 a pound and you still get your $100. What the enemy meant for evil, God is going to turn it around for good in your life. All you have to do is to sit tight and do not do anything. Do not do anything. Just sit there. And all you have to do is to sit there, because God is taking you through the process. I got a few more minutes and my computer looks like it wanna die here. So give me one moment, let me fix this. I think it's important that I share this with you. Give me one more moment. God's gonna get the glory out of everything that we do this morning. Watch this. You see, what God does it creates separation. And I want to call it distinct separation this morning. You see, the discomfort in waiting out of faith versus waiting in faith. So when we wait outside of faith, we do what Sarah did and Abraham, in that when we wait outside of faith, we do what Sarah and Abraham did, in that we look around, and because God made a promise to us, we look at our current circumstance, we evaluate it based on conventional wisdom, and we seek to help God. They look and they saw one of the maid, and Sarah and Abraham came up with this plan that we're going to help God. This is what it looks like when we wait outside of faith. And they went, and she said to him, it is okay because the times in which they live allow him to go in unto a maid, and he would have child and raise up seed on behalf of their family. This, when we wait outside of faith, good God of my salvation, we take our preference and we use it as a substitute to the promise that God has made. And our preference will never take precedence over the promises that God has declared. Ishmael was the byproduct of the decision that they set in motion, waiting outside of faith. And when Ishmael was born, they thought that, yes, God, your word is true. But God says, I called you to wait in faith. And when you wait in faith, there is an Isaac that is coming, which is your promise. Ishmael is your preference, and your preference can't go into your future. It is the promise that I've declared over you that will go and will feed and will guide your future, not your preference. We have a tendency as people of God to abort our future with our preference, my God, and the promises that God has declared over our life. It takes a back seat. So when we wait out of faith in God, here is what we do. We become hearers. We become hearers of the word and not doers of the word. So there's a big difference. When we wait in faith, we become hearers of the word and we set in motion the things that God called us and want us to do. When, my God, we wait outside of faith, we hear it, but we don't do anything about it. Can you hear me now? This too will pass. But the question is, are you hearing what God has to say to you in faith? Or are you hearing what God has to say to you outside of faith? And now, Sister Monica, I'm starting to understand why he's talking to us about faith and fear. Because you see, when I wait out of faith, I have fear as a companion. And because fear is my companion, fear influenced my decision and my action to take my preference and to do something which I can then bring to God and want God to accept a substitute. And when I bring a substitute, what a substitute is, it has a form of godliness. There is no power. There is nothing about a substitute that God can relate to. God is not into accepting any substitute. It is all or nothing with him. Are you waiting in God? Are you waiting outside of God? Are you waiting in faith, or are you waiting outside of faith? Where are you this morning as it relates to what God is declaring unto you? He's asking us the question, can you hear me now? And he makes the declaration, this too shall pass. And when you look at where you are, when you look at your current plight, when you look at your current situation, when you look at the circumstances and where you have been, and you have been there for a long time, and God declare unto you, as he did in 2 Kings chapter number 7, by this time tomorrow, this thing is going to change. The question is, what do you do with that which God declared? Is your response similar to the soldier in the king's army, where you look at what God declared and there is this sarcastic laugh that comes with this? Even if God were to make windows in heaven, this thing ought not to come to pass. And God look at the opposition, which comes from a place of fear, and he says, you will see it, but you will not partake of it. Or are you waiting in him? And because you're waiting in him in faith, he can now declare to you, Sarah and Abraham, that by this time tomorrow, by this time next year, rather, you're going to be with child. And this is of such that when God declare unto you, looking at your current circumstance and situation, is it that you laugh like Sarah did? Because you're looking at where you are, you're looking at what man has to say about your current condition and situation. And you laugh in disbelief. If God says it, it is going to come to pass. And there is absolutely no power under this earth that can stop that which God has declared to become a reality in your life. So now the question that we've got to ask and we've got to answer, am I waiting in faith or am I waiting outside of faith? The scripture says to us that have no confidence in the flesh. My God, and the scripture reminds us of God's response. I said to you at the onset of service that your faith has a voice. And God responded to the faith that he sees. If you were to read St. Matthew chapter number 8 and 10, Luke chapter number 7 and 9, Jesus expressed this explicitly. And when he spoke these words, he was not talking to the church. He was talking to the world. He said, greater faith have I not seen in Israel. Can you hear me now? This too will pass. And the word that God declares unto you, does it first get to your mind? And when it does, is it faith or fear, my God, that encounter the declare word of God? Is it faith or fear? Because you see, that will determine what gets to your heart. Because you see, if it is faith, faith escort the word of God into your heart. And again, your heart is a good fertilizer, and that which God declared now begins to grow. And it has a place that is prepared, my God, to bring forth fruits and a bountiful harvest. So when you hear the word of God and your mind, my God, has faith that connects with the word of God, it moves to your heart. But when God declare his mind and his heart and his word to you, and it comes in contact with fear in your mind, and it has to navigate, my God, this gauntlet in order to get to your heart, this is where our future is now put on hold. Because when we hear what God declare, we tend to look at our current circumstance and situation. It's kind of like what God did when he spoke to Gideon. And when he spoke to Gideon, he said to him, Gideon, thou mighty man of valor. You see, Gideon was just a farmer. He grew up where farming was just what he knows. So to declare to him out of his future that you're a mighty man of valor, Gideon first had to have an encounter with what God declared, and he saw himself only as a farmer. And God had to take him through this process. I'm trying to close and I'm trying to wrap this up because I feel that there is part two to this. Didn't even get to my message yet. You see, when God declared that to him, he couldn't see himself outside of farming. And God now had to take him through the process. And he takes him through the process, and he takes you through the process. He takes me through the process because he wants you and I to have our own authentic experience with him. When Gideon gathered the army to go fight this battle, he brought everybody down to the river. And God said to him, Gideon, and you see, this is where faith and fear are in great competition, because now God says to him, there's this battle that needs to be fought. And now God said to him, take these men, and I want you to bring them down to the creek. And the men that bow their head and lap the water up like a dog with their mouth, those are the ones that we're going to use to fight this. But God, there's a million. I want you to follow what I'm asking you to do, Gideon, because this is a part of the training, Gideon. Eupomone, to hold under until approved. I want to hold you in this space until the things inside of you become mature, wherewith and whereby, if I say to you, Gideon, this or that, there is no hesitation in you to do that which I'm asking you to do. So God, again, he holds us in these places until we mature in the areas in our life where our faith now begins to grow. Gideon, the men that laugh, that's all I need. All you have to do is to be obedient and to follow what God. Don't look about the numbers that are over there. All I need you to do is to follow my instruction. Can you hear me now? Gideon was finished and it was 300 men. It's a daunting task. And what God is asking you to do, it's a daunting task. But he simply sent me here to ask you this as you begin to look in your life and begin to process what he's asking you to do. Is there anything too hard for God? Is there anything too hard for God? Look in your life and look at how God would have taken the impossible and to change, my God, circumstance and situation in your life. Is there anything too hard for him? There is a thin line between fear and faith. And I come this morning to remind you of the importance of walking by faith and not by sight. As people of God, we have a tendency of focusing on the past, keeping record of what worked, what did not work, and using past results and responses to filter action, attitude, and responses as to what comes next. When we get locked into, my God, what is on our radar, and only focus on what we can see, we exclude God's insight and input from the determination and what to comes next. This myopic view, my God, robs us of the opportunity to dream out loud and beyond our current situation. You're right on the verge of a breakthrough. Don't look back and don't go back. Your decision to stick with it and to give up and not to give in to peer pressure. Your decision to stick with this and to follow, my God, what the Lord is asking you to do. Not to be enticed, my God, by the entrapment of the enemy will help you to understand when you get on the other side of what your greatest fears are. It will help you to understand and to see what God declared about you and your life. God's divine revelation and your willingness, my God, to set in motion the thing that he is asking you to do will help you to move beyond your fear. David said, the Lord is my shepherd, and I'm going to pray. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restored my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I would fear no evil. Why? Because thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. While you're going through, you're going through. And the scripture says the step of a righteous man and woman, they're ordered by God. And if God order my steps and I find myself standing in disbelief, it's imperative that we take Deuteronomy chapter number 8 and we look in the mirror of Deuteronomy chapter number 8 and we see ourselves. Because in Deuteronomy chapter number 8, it says, remember the way that I take you to teach you and to prove what is in your heart and to reveal to you what is really and truly in your heart. God is speaking to you. He's speaking to me. He's saying that this too will pass. And the question is, when you hear those words in your mind, is it faith that becomes companion with that word? Or is it fear? Let us pray. Father, we come before you this morning. God, and we are truly, truly grateful. Grateful, oh God, for all that you have done, all that you do, and all that you continue to do. Father, we thank you that even though we oftentimes give up on ourselves, we quit, we turn back like the children of Israel, and we say when it becomes difficult, it would have been better for me to stay in Israel and to eat the garlic and the onion. But you have to remind us, divine revelation come in this moment when we begin to have these type of reasoning with ourselves. And you help us to understand that as long as we were in Egypt, we could not dream out loud. Our dreams, our visions, and our aspirations will never become a reality because of the systems that are in Egypt. Egypt is designed to suppress our creative ability. So to say it was better, my God, it's a cop-out. Why? Because of the challenges that are before us. And those challenges are there so that those immature areas in my life can be mature. When I get to the end of trying to pull conventional wisdom into what God desires, and the frustration begins to amount inside of me, this creates an opportunity, God, for me to turn to you. And when I turn to you, God, because I am in faith in you, this allow you to begin to speak to my spirit and my heart. And you begin to tell me what I need to do and what I do not need to do in this moment. I pray for those of us, God, who are waiting outside of God. I pray for those of us this morning, my God, whose faith, my God, operates outside of you. My prayer, oh God, is that we will come inside. My God, let it be of such that the experience that we have is the type of experience, my God, that the priest had when he goes into the inner courts. God, again, there are three distinct light. There are three distinct separations. You have the outer courts, you have the inner yards, and you have the innermost. The light that shines on the outer, it's sunlight, it's natural sunlight. The light, my God, that is on the inside, it's the menorah, it's man-made, it is fed by olive oil. But the light, my God, and we as your people, we're trying to get to, it's the inner courts, where your presence and the Holy Spirit live. Because God, if I get into your presence, all my fears, my doubts, my concern that I bring, you, oh God, can begin to converse with me and you begin to impart divine revelation to me in your presence. So when I come out of your presence, I come out of your presence with confidence, knowing that even though I may stand in a circumstance or a situation that might seem difficult and hard, because I got your presence, because I got your word rather in your presence, I can now come out and walk in the confidence, knowing that no weapon that is formed against me, God, will prosper. I will walk with my head up, going through the valley of the shadow of death, fearing no evil. Why? Because your rod, it does two things. It disciplines, my God, and it causes me to see you using it to deter the enemy. So when the enemy will come, you use your rod, my God, and you hit him. And he has to move. When I am weak, you use your rod, God, to pick me up. But this only happens when I come into your presence. So my prayer, oh God, as you declare your word to us this morning, is that we would move from the outer courts. We don't want to get to the inner courts. God, our objective is to get into the holies of holies, where we take hard and difficult challenges and we have hard and difficult conversation with you. And we wait for you to speak to us and to instruct us and to tell us what we need to do. Spirit of the living God, we come before you this morning. And for the words that you spoke and declare over our lives, and where faith was not allowed to intercept that word that would catapult us into our future, but fear intercepted that word, thereby leaving us shackled and burdened and overwhelmed and despondent, and we quit and we gave up. You send your word. Again this morning, you said to us, your response here is twofold. And now I understand, God, you breathe upon us. You breathe upon us, God, to blow those things away from us. And now you breathe upon us to blow those things away from us. God, you are now breathing life into us. And because you are breathing life into us, we stand in awe of you, hands lifted up, and we worship you and we praise you. And this is what we're going to do this morning that's different, because this is what the Lord shared with us at the onset of service. We're just going to have a moment where I'm going to unmute all the mics, and we are going to worship God. And because, my God, he has created this moment for us to worship him, two things I'm going to say to you as I hear him saying this to me. By this time tomorrow, whatever it is in your life that is crooked and is not straight, it will be straightened tomorrow. And by this time next year, there is something that has been going on and has been missing. It will become a reality, will manifest itself in your life. So I'm going to declare unto you 2 Kings chapter number 4 and 16. Genesis chapter number 18 and 10. By this time next year, your circumstance will change. And I'm going to declare to you 2 Kings chapter number 7. By this time tomorrow, your circumstance is going to change. So there's twofold. God is going to do it tomorrow, and God is going to do it a year from now. Mark your calendar. Mark your calendar. I hear him say, put me to the test and prove me. Because he wants you to have your own authentic experience of what he does in your life. No longer living through somebody else. This is your own. And because you have your own authentic experience of what he is doing in your life, you can now stand and you can share. And the thing about it, because he is doing this, others who know your circumstance and your situation will sit and they're going to marvel. God is going to take your life, and in essence, he's going to advertise it as a billboard. He's going to put what he has done so others can see. And when they ask and inquire about it, you can now come and say, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man and the woman that put his or her trust in him. He's going to use your life to get the glory and to bring others into the kingdom. And I want to say, prepare yourself. I'm going to unmute the mics.